Okay, guys, welcome back. This is our last week. Tuesday, the exam, final exam, at the time of the lecture, as usual, and you need the browser. We are going to be using, again, the lockdown browser. Review your computer, be sure that you have the software. You're going to have a lab in which you are going to use the software this week, so you can test that everything works. So the exam this week, Tuesday. Obviously, Wednesday, my plan is to do the review as usual. Main topics, in case you want to take a look, starting right now, arrays, for sure, references, and recursion. Those three are going to be the main topics in the final exam. Why? If I ask you about recursion, you're going to notice it's connected with conditions. We cannot do one without the other. If I ask you questions about arrays, they are connected easily with loops. So one question about arrays allow me to test your knowledge of arrays, but also loops. Variables and arrays together with objects, objects and arrays use references. So any question about references is a question about arrays or objects or both. So arrays, recursion, and references, if you have the opportunity to review the lectures from the previous week, those are maybe the most important for the exam. And we're going to be working with them this week. Also Wednesday, your last assignment, assignment 5, is due Wednesday. Very important, assignment 5. I think you want to review that very, very careful. It's a lot of material there that for sure is going to be on the exam. So finish your assignment 5. Any question, let us know. Wednesday is your due date. And basically with that, we're gonna finish the class. 20%, 25% the labs, 25% the assignments, and 50% the 3 exams. That is your final grade. Right now, with the current grades that you have access on Canvas, there is 1 or 2 students with A plus right now. Several of you have a big group, and a lot of Bs. So given those grades that are good to very good, I am not planning to apply any kind of curve or extra points or something. So basically, as we describe in the syllabus and with the numbers that you have, you can calculate your grades. Good? Okay. Question in the chat and you answer. Great. Okay. Recursion. So far, what we have reviewed, everything is a summary of you have classes, you have methods, and a very important method, the main. This is kind of the summary of what is a program in Java. And something that we learn, and you are experts right now, is, well, inside of the methods, we put things, conditions, loops, variables, array, reference, whatever. They are inside of the methods. The methods are the important component in the program. You separate your problem into methods, and then each method does something to solve a particular problem. When you have methods, something that you do is this idea of one method call another method. This concept is important, is the one that we're going to be reviewing today, is one method call another method. One method is the one that put another one to work. And if you remember your program, only one method in the program is executed by the computer. My computer read my program, one class or more, and the only thing that the computer do is call the main. That's it. And if the main call another one, and that another one call another one, that connection is your program running. These methods calling one another. Now, this calling is very well organized. When one method finish, that method return to the one that call him or call it. So if I am here, in some line, I call this method up. This method is going to run, it's going to run all the instructions, everything is going to be executed. And when you found the closing curly bracket, you return immediately after the calling to the method. So when you return all the calls and you finish with the main, in that point, your program finished. So entry point, someone, the computer, call the main. And then something happened inside. And finally, when the main returned, the program finished. Now, at this point, I would like to review with you what is happening in the memory, because that is going to be the thing that we're going to use today. If I have a program, what happened in my program, in the computer, when this program is running? Well, let me tell you this. Step number one, when you run a program, so when you call the main, something that is going to happen is in the memory of your computer, that program is going to use memory. Number one, you are going to put in the memory the global variables for that program. So when you call the main, the first thing that the computer is going to do before starting to execute these lines is to put in the memory any possible variable that is global. And those variables are going to be in a very particular place. Then you are going to create in a particular section of the memory. This section is called the stack. When you run a program, you're going to put your global variables in one particular space. Then your program is going to have another space, another section, call it the stack. And in that section, your program can put the variables that are locals, the variables that correspond to the methods. That section have a specific size. It's not like you can use local variables forever. You run your program, you have a space for the globals, you're going to have a space for the locals. The name of the space is the stack. Every time that you create a local variable, every time that you call a method, you're going to use a space in that place, in the stack. I am sure that you're familiar with this error in the computer. If you have a Windows machine, if you saw a blue screen sometime, maybe you read the error, Stack Overflow. If you are running Java and you try to allocate a lot of memory in an array or something, maybe you saw the Stack Overflow exception. Stack Overflow means that you do not have more memory. In particular, that you do not have more memory here in the stack. That is the reason of the Stack Overflow, that you do not have more space for your local variables, for your methods, because they are going to be in that particular zone of the memory. Now, another important concept that we're going to be using a little bit, when you have the memory of your computer and you run a program, your program is going to use this global section and it's going to have this stack section. Any space in the RAM that your program is not using, it's like the space that is not mine. Is called the heap. Think about this. If we are in a classroom, the professor and the students, and we are a program, like each of us is one method in this program, the classroom is our space. The classroom is our stack. And we're going to have a stack overflow if we try to put a lot of students inside of that classroom. Any other classroom in the campus, the parking lots, the building in front, whatever, all that places are the heap for us. Obviously, for the people in the classroom in front of us, we are the stack, or we are part of the heap for them. We are part of this space that is not theirs. So this is my RAM. For this program, this is the stack, this is the heap. If another program is running in some place, this other program that is running is going to have the globals, its own stack, and the heap is everything else, including this program, everything else. Good. Now, what is going to happen here? When you run a program, the first thing is global variables go to the global variable section. Then, when you enter to the main, automatically, inside of the stack, you are going to create this space that is for the main method. Think about this. You are going to start with the program. You are asking the main to run. Well, inside of the stack, you run, you are going to put a particular table, a particular space for the main. So any local variable that the main creates is going to be inside of this space. So if inside of the main, I create an integer variable x, then inside of the stack for the main, inside of that section, I am going to have this variable x 4 bytes because it's integer. If I have another variable y for the main, I am going to have the variable y for the main in some place inside of the stack, inside of the particular section of the method. That's it. If the main call another method, I am going to call that one m, any name. When the main calls another method, what is going to happen is immediately when you do the call, you are going to create a space inside of the stack for that particular method m. And if that method m have a local variable x, can we have two local variables with the same name? Hopefully you remember, yes. You can have variables with the same name if they are local to two different methods, right? And the reason is because that x inside of the method m, well, is going to be here. And as you can notice, even though both are in the stack, they are inside of different places. One belongs to the method M and the other to the method main. They are separate, not the same. Now, if by any chance you have a global variable X, that is also possible because your global X is here. So we can use the same name for the globals and for the locals. Moreover, for the locals, even though they have the same name, they are different things because the model that we have for the memory. Now, what happened with the stack? What will happen with this stack overflow? Well, two possibilities. Number one, you can make the stack go overflow if you have a lot of local variables in one of the methods. But also, as you can notice, I run main, I run M, and if this method M call another method like this one, when I run that one, well, I am going to create another space for that method. And just as happened with my slides, in some point, if you run a lot of methods, you are going to go to overflow in the stack, right? Now, this is what happened when you call the methods. What happened when those methods return? For instance, here, I call this foo. In some point, foo is going to do all the statements. And when foo reach the closing curly bracket, this foo is going to return. At this point, question in your exam, foo is going to return to M or foo is going to return to main? Well, you know that the method return to the one that call the method. In this case, if I told you that M is the one that called foo, you know that when foo finish, foo is going to return and continue in M. What happened when a method return? The most important thing that you need to know is when a method return, when a method finish, this box here, all the space that that method has in the stack is going to be deleted. So when the method foo return, what happened is that the computer is going to delete everything in this box. Everything. What I am telling you is the local variables exist from the point in which you call the method and until the method return. When you call the method, the local variables exist. The computer create the local variables. When you return from that method, everything that corresponds to that method and you put on the stack is going to be deleted, removed. All the local variables are going to disappear. So, as you can imagine, foo return to M, in some point M is going to finish also, and M is going to return to main. When that happens, everything inside of M is going to disappear. So now you are back in main. The only thing in the memory is main itself. You have a space. So if you take a look to the memory of your computer, when you are running a program, every single time that you run a method, you are using more memory. More. But when your method returns, they allocate memory. So your use of memory go down. And your program is running, and hopefully the memory is kind of using memory, releasing memory. Using memory, maybe a lot, release, and so on. And as far as you keep that using and release in these limits, your program is fine. If in some point you try to use more memory than the one that you have in your stack, you're going to have this error. Make sense? Okay, why this is important? Well, exactly the same behavior happen if you have everything in one class, like this example, or you have several classes. You have this one section for the global variables, and you have this stack, and in the stack, always, and you can expect the first space that you're going to have down is the space for the main. The space for the main is going to be always there. And then you're going to have methods running, and it could be a method here because this main call this one, or it could be that this one call a method in a different file. So this is main. This one here could be this one, and this one is a different class, a different file, but it's the one that is running there. When you are running your program in the memory, there is no difference between one file or the other. It's just one program, and your program is the one that have this space in the memory for globals and for the stack. So this idea of methods, this idea of the stack, this idea of the variables inside of these small boxes or the spaces is the same. Doesn't matter if you have something like this, one file, something like this. Obviously, the computer don't care if we're talking about the static or non-static objects or not. This is the model for the memory management. And it's the same for the Java Virtual Machine, Windows, Mac, whatever. That is the way that the programs are going to run. Why I am talking about this use of the memory? Well, so far, I am talking about what happened when one method called another one. Doesn't matter which one is that other one. Now let's talk about recursion. I mentioned this in one of our previous lectures. Recursion basically is when one method calls itself. A method that is calling itself is a recursive method. So this idea of recursion is this idea about one method executing itself. It can be directly, like inside of this method, I have a call to myself, which is valid, or it will be indirectly, like this method calling this one, but that one calling back this one. So you have this loop, but not me to myself, but me to another and that another to me. So there is a loop between both of us. Direct or indirect call. Direct or indirect recursion. This idea of one method in this loop executing itself or another that then call the first one, that is what creates a recursive call. Why this is important? Let's review why. So, the most important thing here for me that I need you to remember is the following. It doesn't matter how many methods do you have. It doesn't matter if they are in the same class or not, but think about the following. Yes. When you think about recursion, immediately, it's like, that is a loop, Yes, you are right. That is the similarity between two teams that you know. Well, loops you know, recursion you will know. Recursion is a tool to create a loop. But one small thing that I need you to remember. Just imagine the following scenario. I have this method main, and main is going to call a method foo. And this is my method foo here. And this foo is going to call itself. So I am creating this kind of loop, right? The computer is going to run main. Main is going to call foo. Foo is going to call itself. And that's it. Now, I am going to put here variables. In particular, I am going to put in foo a variable x. This scenario, the source code that I am adding with red is something that you already know. It's something that you can create. It's nothing new, really. I need to show you what is happening in the memory. And according with my previous explanation, you can agree with me. Well, number one, the computer is going to give us a space for the global variables. Maybe we have global variables, maybe not, but we're going to have the space. The computer is going to give us a space for running the methods and for the local variables. The computer is going to give us the stack. We need to be careful with the stack, because if we fill the stack, we're going to have a stack overflow. So we need to be careful with that. Now, in this particular program, I am going to run the method main. As usual, nothing happened. So in the main, if I have a variable x, y in the main, that variable y is going to be here. Call the main. I have main, I have the variable, everything fine. Now, this y is going to disappear when the main finish. We agree on that. When you finish the method, this block is going to be deleted. Main is going to call foo. Let me be clear. The main hasn't finished. The main is maybe here in the middle, and you're calling another method. The main is still alive, and the main is going to be here waiting for this foo to finish. If you look to the memory, in that particular point, these two methods are alive, right? Because main hasn't finished, it's there. Foo now is running. It's running, and you're going to have a variable x inside. They are there. But then, in some point inside of the method, you're going to create this loop, because the method is going to call itself. The common error for the programmers is to think about, well, foo is already running, and foo is going to call itself. Well, that means basically to move from the instruction here to the instruction at the beginning. That is a loop. Moving from one point to another, that is a while or a do while or a for loop, right? Calling the method again is exactly a continue will be this moving from one instruction to the other. Recursion is not that Recursion is something different. Recursion is when you call the method again, you're going to create another space in the stack for foo, and that new space have an integer variable x because you have a variable x there. So if I call myself, that basically means something like create a clone of myself. So when I call myself, it's more like asking another method that is basically a clone of me to do something. That is the big difference here. It's not just change the line. It's not only loop the instructions. It looks like that because this arrow here. It could work in that way, but what you are doing when you call a method, even if that method calls itself, is to create a new space in the stack, and that new space have all the local variables that are in that method. And in this particular case, the original foo have a variable x. When you call foo inside, you have a second variable x. And what happens if that second copy is also going to call itself? You are going to have another space here, foo with a variable x. Okay, but that copy is going to call itself. Another one, and another one, and another one, and another one. If you call a method like this, the result, sooner or later, Stack Overflow. It's a loop, but every single time you are asking for memory for the new copy. And every single time, if you have variables, like in this case x, you have a new variable x. Okay, we can agree about the following. A method can call itself. There is no problem, but we need to be careful about, in some point, we need to stop the calling, because if we do a program and our program is just calling myself without any condition, my program is going to do this. And let me be clear, there is a difference between a Stack Overflow and an infinite loop. Because you can have a loop with a bad condition or without a condition, and that loop is going to be running forever, right? An infinite loop. Do we understand the difference between an infinite loop and this Stack Overflow that happened with recursion? The most important thing is an infinite loop is not an error. An infinite loop is something that maybe you want, and I give you examples. A web server have an infinite loop. It's running forever, waiting for connections. A Stack Overflow is an error. A Stack Overflow is something that you do not want to happen. A Stack Overflow is the blue window in a PC, right? Happy face, but what happened is something crash. Stack Overflow is your computer crashing. An infinite loop is just a program running. And you have several programs in your computer running in an infinite loop, depending on what you have in your computer, but several of them, all these processes running in the background are infinite loops. This is an error. This is okay. Source code. definition for your exam. A recursive method is a method that is calling itself. Hopefully that part is clear. Source code. If you put this in your computer, if you put this in a class and you run the program, what is going to be the result? How many times I am going to have on the screen, hello? Exactly. Remember the same example with loops. If I put this line in an infinite loop, I am going to have hello forever in my computer. As long as my computer is on, I am going to have hellos, 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 hellos happening. An infinite loop is not going to crash. It's going to be working. This particular example, calling say hello again. This is creating this loop that you describe in the chat. We can create a loop with recursion, but the problem is every single time that you call the same method, remember in your stack, say hello one, say hello two, say hello three, say hello four, all of these are copies in the memory. And in some point, the memory, the stack, is not going to have more space. And in that point, this particular program is crash, fail. This program is going to print hello as long as it can continue running. And that is going to happen as long as I have memory to allocate new copies, new spaces for say hello method. Basically, in a loop, you do not create stack overflows because you are not creating more data. If you are using while, do while, or for, what you're going to have is just an infinite loop. If you are using recursion and you are not careful, like here, always the result is going to be a stack overflow. Always. A stack overflow is this infinite loop that in some point is going to crash. Stack overflow is an error that is connected with working with recursion. One way to create a stack overflow, one way to crash a computer, one way to do these programs that go and attack your computer and crash your computer, the easy way, a recursive method. It is tricky. I am going to talk about it. Two things that you are learning that are dangerous tools. Number one, we reviewed the previous week, arrays. This number that you put indicating how many elements you want in an array, that is a tool that is important to be careful, because what happens if you create an array and your array is 1 terabyte, 1000000 size. You can create problems in your computer, not with Java, but with another languages. And the second one, maybe the most important, recursion. It's very easy to crash a computer with a recursive method. Again, not with Java, because remember, your program in Java is running inside of the virtual machine. Best case scenario, worst case scenario, you crash the virtual machine, nothing is going to happen. You're not going to create a blue screening windows using Java. In other languages, recursion exists, and you're going to review those in a different class. It's one of the ways. Recursion is one of the ways to do that, crash your computer. Not with Java, but think about something like this in C++. You're going to do this in C++ later in the 240 class. You are going to have recursion, and you're going to have a programming language, C++, that allow you to run your program, not inside of a virtual machine, but directly in the hardware of the computer. And that is very, very powerful and dangerous. That is the skills that we teach to the programmers. This is recursion. Hopefully now we are clear regarding what is the meaning of recursion. Now, we agree that the good thing is the loop. We agree. The bad thing is this Stack Overflow. The question for you is, what can I do to have this good thing, the loop? Because it seems like this loop is easy than my for loop, or at least the same. So I would like to use it. But I am worried about the Stack Overflow, right? What can I do? Well, I am sure that you figure out the solution. This is what you can do. Always, 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 a rule that I can share with you, the answer for the question in the chat regarding how to avoid a recursive method to crash, how to avoid this Stack Overflow, the answer is very simple, an if condition. Every single time that you read a recursive method, every single time that you create a recursive method, when you use recursion and your goal is to solve a problem, not to create one, using recursion, a recursive method, always, always, always is going to have a condition inside. Why? Very simple. This is your recursive method. You are going to call the method, right? What you're going to have always in a recursive method is two options. Option number one is do something and call the method again. Do you remember? The condition is true. So go again, like the continue in the loops. And a second scenario that is not calling the method again. A second scenario in which you stop the recursive calls. Think about it in terms of what is happening in the RAM, in the memory. For this program, somehow I have my global variables. I have the stack. In the stack, I have this main, and the main is going to call this say hello. And say hello is going to call itself. I don't know how many times, but each time the program is reviewing a condition. This is different because before each time the copy create another copy and there is no point to stop. In some point it's going to be a Stack Overflow. Here, every single time, because this if else, maybe the condition is going to be false or true. I mean, the condition is going to be different. And in that point, that line is not going to create another copy. And the advantage of that is, if this one do not create another copy, this method is going to finish. And when that method finish, one is going to go back, return to the one that called him, and this is going to be deleted. This one that is back, in some point is going to finish and it's going to be deleted. and the same with this one, and so on. So in some point, your program is going to finish. Always, 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 an if condition with a recursive method. Now, moreover, something that we need to do. We need a condition. We need to create a condition. Usually, when you create recursive methods, that condition is going to be connected with a parameter that you send to the method. Why with a parameter? Think about it. Every method is creating a copy of itself. So you have several different copies. All of them are identical. You cannot differentiate one from the other. If you want to create a condition to stop something, and basically what you have is identical copies, it's going to be a challenging task to create a condition which have a different result from one copy and from the other. However, if you use for the condition a parameter, the good news is you can send a value as a parameter that probably could be different for each of your clones, for each of your copies. And then that information can help you to stop the copy. Very common for recursion. You are going to create a recursive method. Number one, you need a condition. Number two, you need parameters. And the parameters are going to be connected with the condition for that if-else statement. What is happening in the memory in my example here? Well, let me show you. Number one, my computer room. I have the global section. I do not have global variables here. It's going to be empty, but I have the box there. I am going to have the main. Nothing new. The main is going to call say hello. That call is going to create a box for say hello. Say hello. Do I have local variables in say hello in this example? And hopefully your answer is yes. This parameter, the parameters are local variables, remember? So this parameter, num, is a variable inside of say hello. This number five, when you call the method, it's going to go to the variable num. This num here is going to have a five there, and that is the five that main sent to that hello, say hello. Okay. This method, the one that is at the top, is going to do the instructions, and the method is going to check like num is equal zero, and it's like, which num? My num is five. Five is equal to zero? No. It's going to go to the else. You remember conditions now. So it's going to go to the else. Inside of the else, it's going to run this instruction. You're going to have hello on the screen. It's going to go down. It's going to do this call. That means is not a loop. I am not just going back to the line one. This call here, exactly the same that this one here, is asking me to create another copy in the memory for the method. So I have another copy for the method say hello, and therefore another local variable num. Okay, this one is a file. What about this one? Well, did you notice the value in the parentheses? Num. Num here. -1, 4. And I am going to send that 4. And that 4 is going to be stored there. Guys, I need you to notice that at this point, I have parallel words. At this point, I have two copies of say hello. Each of them have a variable num, but one have a 5 and the other have a 4. At the same time, I have the local variable x inside of the method say hello with two different values, both. It didn't happen what usually happens, that one value replaced the other. If we do a loop, the new value, the 4, replace the 5. That didn't happen here. The 5 is there. And the 4 is there also. Good? The main exists because the main hasn't finished. This copy of say hello, the clone number 1, exists because it hasn't finished. And the new clone exists because I am just did the calling. Okay, so now I am here in the new say hello. In which line? In the line 1, right? Num is equal 0. Which num? Which value I am comparing with 0? The 4, the one at the top, right? Okay, 4 is not 0. Okay, you know what is going to happen. Go here, and it's the second time that you print hello on the screen. It's like a loop, second time. But notice what happened in the memory. That thing that is happening in the memory, all those copies do not happen in a common loop. Okay. Say hello again. The method is calling itself. And what is going to happen is the same thing that happened when you call a method. Another copy for say hello. And that copy also have a variable num. Another copy of variable num. Say hello is calling say hello. And it's going to send a value. This one is the one that is going to send a value. And it's going to send num -1. Which num? The 5? The 4? Hopefully you agree with me, the 4. We are working with this guy here, the one that have a 4 in num. And what we're going to send to the new copy, to the new guy, is 4 minus 1, a 3. And now, I was here. But when I do the call, I have this new copy in the memory. And I am back in the first line, because that is what happens when you do a call. I am in the first line again. And is if num equals 0. And the question is num, which one? The 5, the 4, or the 3? Well, You are in the tree. You are the one that was called and received a tree. So for you, is 3 equal 0? And the answer is no. And therefore you go to the else and you print hello again. And then you are going to call another clone, say hello, which means you're going to create another space, say hello, and that guy is going to have another variable num, and that one is going to be 3 minus 1. This one is going to have a 2. How many memory I am using right now? Every single time that I call, say hello, I am creating a new variable num, that is a new variable int. So every single time that I call the method, at least I am adding 4 bytes to the memory. I am asking for 4 new bytes. You're going to be able to create a lot of copies of say hello, but adding 4 bytes to each call, in some point you're going to have the Stack Overflow. Now, I am here and I am back in the line 1. Num is equal 0. The 2 is equal 0. No. Again, print hello. And again, do a copy. This one is going to do another copy. Say hello. Another variable num. And this one is going to send num minus 1. His num, the 2, minus 1. This one is going to have a 1. And you are back in the first line. Num, the 1, is equal to 0. No. Print hello, another hello, and call again, another copy. Say hello, another copy of the variable num. This one is going to send num 1 minus 1. This one is going to be equal 0. Excuse me. And when I am here, I am going to go back to the line 1. And now, for this guy, for this clone, he's going to ask if num is equal 0. And for him, yes, num is equal 0. This condition is true. Therefore, he's going to print hello and bye. And then what happened? Well, as you remember, if you execute the if part, then you do not do the else, and you go to the next line after the if condition. Remember, we just run the if, we print hello and bye, this copy did that, and that's it. We reach the closing curly bracket. What happened when a method reach the closing curly bracket? Well, that method return, right? Even if it's void, when you reach the closing curly bracket, the method finish, and you return. You return this one. This one is going to return, but also because the method return, the computer is going to delete this. That space in the memory, because the method finish, is going to be clean, and you return. And the point is, return where? Well, you return to the same method that called you, right? So this say hello is going to return to the previous say hello. The say hello with the zero is going to return to the say hello with the one. In which of the lines? It's going to return here to the line one to check the condition again. Hopefully you remember, no, that is not going to happen. You go to the line one when you call the method. When you return, you are going to return exactly here after the calling, right? So that one with the num zero is going to return here after the calling. And when you return here, you are going to go down, and what you have here is the closing curly bracket of the else. You continue down, and you have the closing curly bracket of the method, and basically return, and the only thing that is going to happen is you finish. You reach this point, which basically means that this guy is also going to return because the method finished, and all this is going to be deleted. Did you notice what happened? When you reach this point in which you are not doing any more recursive calls, suddenly you start going down and everything starts finishing? Yeah, it is possible. Answering the question in the chat, here, the only thing that I am doing is to put with the number, I stop to the recursion, to the recursive calls. But depending on the computer you are using and depending of the size of the variables and several different factors, yes, if you put a number that is too big, like that one, well, maybe not that one, but something bigger, maybe a long number, you can have the Stack Overflow still. Well, two things. In Java, it's not about the RAM memory, because remember, all this that I am showing you is running inside of the Java virtual machine. And the Java virtual machine is basically another program running in your computer. So in this case, for the Java programs, you are trusting in how many memory, how many RAM the virtual machine has. But in another languages, like C++, yes, you basically are depending on how many RAM do you have. So in a computer with some megabytes of RAM, you are going to have a Stack Overflow before than using the same computer with more memory. And think about it. That is the reason, because sometimes you have one program and you run that program in one computer and the program crash. And you run the same program in another computer, maybe with more resources, and that program works perfect. And for some people, it's like, oh, the problem is the computer. That computer is not working. No, the problem is the program. The program is using a lot of resources. So the first computer do not have those resources, so crash. The second computer have those resources, so the program run. Java is safe. Remember, the virtual machine is like this nanny that is taking care of everything. Java is be safe. Java is like the kid with the nanny. C++ is freedom. Freedom is you can do whatever you want. And freedom is about responsibility. So when you use C++, you can do a lot of damage in your computer. Well, damage means Stack Overflow. So a programmer that is programming with C++ should be a little bit more responsible than a programmer in Java, because the programmer in Java, nothing happened. I mean, you really, again, if you're programming in Java right now, it's impossible that you create a blue screen in your Windows PC. It's not going to happen. In C++, you can do that. In C++, the cost of an error could be a little bit higher. I mean, your computer crashed and you need to reset. That is what I am talking. So yeah, that is the reason, because you do not learn as your first language, C or C++. That can happen later. Good. So going back to the example, return, and when the main return, the program finish. And this is my example with everything happening in the memory for a loop that is going to be able to print 5 times or this number of times, hello. And you can be thinking like, I can do this with a for loop and do not risk a Stack Overflow. You're right, but this is just an example. I am going to show you other examples. Let me be clear with this. Any program that you can create with recursion, there is an equivalent version that can be done with loops. And also the opposite. For every single program that you can create with loops, there is the possibility to create the same software with recursion. There is a 1-1 equivalence, loops and recursion. Sometimes, and I am going to show you examples, the recursive version is small than the loop. Sometimes, the recursive version is easy to understand than the loop. I am going to show you examples. This is clear, hopefully. Now, help me. Now you understand recursion. I add some lines here, and I add some lines here. In particular, this line, and I modify this line. Can you imagine working paper, what is going to be printed on the screen when I run this program? And this is a question for your exam. Source code, what is going to be printed on the screen? If you're able to tell me what is going to be printed on the screen, that basically means that you understand what is happening. And in this case, that you understand recursion. Zero to 10 to zero, yes, and something else. And that is the tricky part. Let me show you. 10 to zero, I agree. This extra zero, I agree. And yes, something else. Okay, I make the point. That is the tricky part. Twice, yes, that is what is going to happen. Let me show you. So this is very, 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 very important for you to have clear, because this is the tricky part of recursion. And let me run this example. And the only thing that I am going to do, I am going to put a 5 here. Just allow me to use the 5 instead of the 10, just because I want to stop like before. 5 copies, not 10 copies. You can make it the 10 copies, but I do not have a space here for the 10 copies, so assume that I am going to call 5 times. Let's see what is happening in the memory, and be sure to do this in your exam. So, number one, I am going to have this space for the global variables. I do not have global variables, so I don't care. I am going to have this main copy, the method main. There is no variables in the main, well, args, but I am not going to use that one, so use the main. And then main is going to call a copy for the method print numbers. And that method has a variable num. And hopefully you agree with me. The first number that I received there is the 5. This 5 He's going to travel and he's going to go here and he's going to be in the first copy. Five. Okay, five. That copy, the first one, is going to run the source code. Five equal to zero, false. Therefore, that one is going to go here. And the first thing that you are going to print on the screen, according with this, is new, right? So I am in the first copy, and the first copy is doing this line. You are going to have on the screen a five. Second, I am going to create a clone. Very important, guys. This print here is not going to happen until this clone here return, right? Because I need to finish this line before continue with the other lines. You can think about this copy like this one entity. And I am reading the program, but in this point, I am creating a clone that is another copy. And basically for that one, I am going to give him this, not minus one. I am going to give him a four. And I am not going to be able to continue until this guy returns to me. So basically for this one, with the value five, I am here waiting for the other to go back to me, because only one of these can be running. Good. So I print the five, that's it. Now I create a clone, a copy. The copy receives a four. And that copy, now this one is going to read num is equal zero. No. It's going to print four. And it's going to create a copy. And the copy is going to receive a three. That one, the clone, is going to check 3 equals 0. No, it's going to print the 3. And it's going to create a copy. And that one is going to do the same. It's going to print a 2. It's going to create a copy. And that one is going to receive a one. And it's going to create a copy. And that one, the last one, is going to read this num is zero. For him, that is true. And that one, the only thing that it's going to do is to print. No. That one is going to print zero and nothing else. It's going to go here and here. It's going to return. It's the first one that return. This one print the zero and then return. Return where? Here, right? This one hasn't finished. When the previous one returned here, this one go down, and this one is going to execute this line. Tell me, what is going to be printed on the screen? Can we agree that This one is the one that is running right now, and for him, noon is one. So when him run this line, he's going to print one. After print one, it's going to go down, it's going to finish. So this one is going to return. And when this one returns, now this is the one running. Running where? In this point, because I return to that point. Okay? And what is the value for noon that I am going to print in this instruction? But now in this scenario, and then that one is going to return here, and that one is going to return here, and that one is going to return here. So are you telling me that I return to exactly the same point in which I stop? Mm-hmm. And when I return, the values that I found are the same values before I make the call. So this clone here is printing num two times. At both times, is printing a 5. And then this one, both times, is printing a 4. And this one, two times, is printing a 3. But in the middle, I have these recursive calls. So that is the reason, because I print my 5, but then I need to wait for something else to happen, and then I can print my 5. And the same happened with the guys inside. And the most important thing is the 0 was printed only one time, because the 0 was printed here by the last method that was created. And that one only had one print. And he used that for the 0. All the other numbers are two times, because there are two prints for that num in the else scenario. Yes, you can use the return instruction. Yeah, no problem. Here, because I am returning when the method finish, I do not have returns, but yes, you can have returns. So the most important thing, recursive method, always parameters and conditions. But the most important is every single call to a recursive method is a new copy of the variables. And it doesn't matter that you call another copy. Your variables are going to be there. When you return, when the execution returns to you, for each of these copies, they still have the value of num that they have before going to the other copy. So you have this scenario in which you have multiple versions of the same method running at the same time, but you have one with the information 5 and another one with the information 4 and another one with the information 3 and so on. And basically you are jumping between those copies, going forward and backward basically. Makes sense. I would like to see more examples. Local variables always stay there. I would like you to review the following, guys. Why do we need recursion? Well, you know why? Because a lot of problems in math are recursive. And I need to show you two examples. The classical example of a recursive problem is calculate the factorial of a number. Why? Yeah, because when they explain to you what is factorial, what is the factorial of a number? What they do is telling you like, what is the factorial of the number 5? And your math teacher told you like, oh, you know, the factorial of 5 is 5 times the factorial of 4. Ah, this is a recursive definition. And what is the factorial of 4? Ah, the factorial of 4 is 4 times the factorial of 3. And you can continue. This is clear, right? It's like, okay, in order to calculate the factorial of 10, I need to calculate the factorial of 9, 8, 7, and so on. Uh-huh. Okay, but this is stopped in some point? Ah, yeah, of course, the factorial of 0 or the factorial of 1 is equal to 1. Okay, for 1 or for 1, I can use this rule. And for any other number, it's like I need to do all of that. Uh-huh. And in this point, I can tell you, guys, I need you to do a program that calculates the factorial of a number in Java. You have two options. Option number one, you can use a loop. And it's like, do your loop. You know how to do loops. The condition is going to involve exactly that, like equal one in some point. Or you can try with a recursive version. It's an exercise for you. But I want to show you quickly what is the recursive version for the factorial. It's very small, right? It's very easy to read. Because one parameter, the number that you want to calculate the factorial, one condition, 0 is 1, or you can use 1 is 1. And else, this one return an integer, so I am using return, and you are telling me that if the number is 0, the factorial is 1, but if the number is not 0, any other thing, the factorial is the number times a recursive call n minus 1. That looks like for 5 is 5 times 4 factorial of 4. For 4 is 4 times factorial of 3. That is the solution. The rules in math, the software. A lot of problems in math can be matched to a code like this. Which one is better? Two things that you need to evaluate. Which one use more resources in your computer? Which one is more expensive in terms of the resources, memory and CPU that is using in your computers? A loop or recursion? More expensive. Recursion. As I showed you before, every single call is a new space in the memory. Recursion is more expensive. Recursion needs more memory and more CPU. If your program, you care about performance, if you have a small amount of memory or a CPU that is not a good idea to be calling methods, if you are working with some system embedded that usually you care more about resources, recursion is not a good idea. Recursion is going to use more resources. So in those cases, create a for loop, create a loop. Advantage for recursion. Usually, a recursive version of a solution is easy to read, is easy to understand. So let me tell you in this way, recursion is easy for the humans. Well, for the humans with a little bit of experience programming, just because the problem and the solution, the programming and the math looks alike, easy to read, easy to understand, but this program is going to use more resources than the equivalent with loops. In programming, you have both tools. You have the recursion and you have the loop. Which one you use, depending on the problem, depending on what you are doing, and if you care or not about performance, if you need to take care or not about the memory. And obviously, if you understand and feel comfortable using or not recursion, is up to the programmer, up to the problem. It's depending. You are doing this video game. It's a video game that you are going to be running in which system? Think about it. Good video games, the good ones, do not run in a computer with megabytes of memory. And the reason is because maybe the programmer, instead of working in a solution with loops, maybe work with recursion. And the programmer know that it's going to use a lot of memory. Use, put in the game, this game requires a lot of memory. Solve. In a video game for a console, PlayStation, Xbox, whatever, the resources, the memory, and the CPU are not an issue. You can use, and the people use recursion. Just because having a solution that is easy to understand is more important. Look at this, 4 lines of code, 4 lines. And it's very easy to notice which is the stop point and which is the general solution. Try to do the factorial calculation with a loop. It's going to be small, maybe 5, 6 lines. Maybe you can have 4, but if you try to explain the program to another person, it's going to be a little bit more complicated to explain the loop than explaining this version. This version can be even be understood by someone that do not know programming, because this and even this is kind of explaining the maths. That is the power of recursion, the level of abstraction in the solution, the similarities between the mathematical solution and what you do in the program, even though the disadvantage is memory and CPU, because all this cloning process that I explained to you. The last example that I want you to review, please, I am sure that you remember this one. You did this one with loops. You have your solution for this one with loops. Do you remember the Fibonacci numbers? I talk about this in the review for the exam. You did this in the lab. These numbers that you start with the 0 and the 1, and then the next number is the addition of the previous 2, and then the next number is the addition of those, and then the next one is the addition of those, and you keep moving. One case, Fibonacci of 0 is 0, Fibonacci of 1 is 1, and for any other is the addition of the previous one with the addition with 2 before, right? So 0, 1, 1, 2. This one is the addition of the previous one and 2 before. This is the mathematical definition. This is the program with recursion. And again, I want to notice 0, 0, 1, 1. And the general solution? And that one looks like the mathematical problem. Again, if you show this to someone, and maybe you have a team with someone that is an expert in the mathematical part, but not exactly a programmer, understand this version or understand the other version, the one with loops. Usually this one is easy to understand just because, again, the similarities with the definition of the problem. So in conclusion, recursion, easy to understand, small, that is the pro, the cons, resources, cost, in terms of, obviously I am talking about time and memory. That's it. As usual, and I am sorry for the time, please copy paste these programs, run this program, and be sure that you can understand what we reviewed today regarding the clones and regarding this same variable that exists in several different moments with several different values. Any question? Good. So please review this and we continue tomorrow. Thank you.